Father, we do just really want to come into your presence with, above all else, greater than anything else, with thanksgiving in our hearts, and enter into your courts with praise. And we pray that that would be so, Lord, that we wouldn't just be saying it, we wouldn't just be praying it, we wouldn't just be singing it, but would truly be able to press through and enter into your courts with praise, with real, deep, sincere, honest thanksgiving in our hearts. In Jesus' name, amen.
That you would bear my cross. Jesus, I sing for all that you've done for me.
Shadows, you and every breath. Transgressions from us. As far as east is from the west. Set down from glory to where I sit.
Last couple of days I've been very much dwelling on the end of Romans 13, where it says already the hour for you to awaken from sleep. It is already the hour to awaken from sleep right now. For now salvation is nearer to us than when we believed. The night is almost gone. The day is near. Therefore, let us lay aside the deeds of darkness and put on the armor of light. Let us behave properly as in the day. The first two you may think are not really an issue for us, not in carousing and drunkenness, not in sexual promiscuity. But the last three, I think, would really be what the Lord would say to us, not in sensuality. That's just basically satisfying self. Not in strife. Not in jealousy. But put on the Lord Jesus Christ and make no provision at this time. The Lord would really urge us. Don't make provision for the flesh in regards to its lust. But what interested me is that all of this is talking about how it's end times, the day is almost upon us, really a great urgency. But if you go a few verses back up from there, it says, verse 8, owe nothing to anyone except to love one another. He who loves his neighbor has fulfilled the whole law. And then it talks about the commandments. And again, verse 10, love does no wrong to a neighbor. Therefore, love is the fulfillment of the law. And so the Lord would really urge us at this time to really be aware and to be pushing into the whole thing of loving other people. Very, very easy in this day just to get caught up in the times, caught up in what's going on, caught up in our own lives and our own responsibility, maybe to even walk uprightly with God. But the key to all of that, and as Paul says there, the key to the fulfillment of the whole law is love. And the Lord would urge us this morning, don't neglect, don't overlook, don't just put aside the whole thing of loving other people. Absolutely crucial.
You know, as I walked up here, I said, Lord, if ever there's a time that I would have liked to have been the local farm boy here, it's now. So that you can accept me with all my mistakes and all my ideas and just say, well, that's Quirbus, we've got to accept him. So let's pray. Father, I thank you for this opportunity. I've realized yet again, but in a deeper revelation of standing here and having the privilege and the honor of sharing your word. Father, I know that there is nothing new under the sun. I know, Father, that every one of us is going to remember or have heard what I am to share. But Father, I pray that your Spirit will speak to these people here this morning. Your people, Father, your sheep. I am but a voice piece. And I ask you, Father, for your wisdom and discernment. And Lord, as John prayed about love, I pray, Lord, that every word that rolls off my lips will be out of an utter love and a care for the sheep. Have your way this morning, Father. But Lord, we are reminded that our hearts have to be ready. Our hearts need to be the good soil. And I pray right now, Father, that whatever has entered our hearts from the cares of the world, the anxieties, the challenges, from relationships, and just the general living in and on this earth, I pray that all those be removed right now in the name of Jesus. And Lord, give us hearts ready to receive. And Lord, we can only receive if our ears are tentative and open by your Holy Spirit. And Father, we can only see your glorious promises if we see through your eyes. Open our spiritual eyes that we may see your glory here this morning. And I pray this in the precious name of Jesus Christ. Amen. I'd like to talk to you about what God has given you and what have you done with what Almighty God has given you. And I know I was changed and I was warned that certain things will change when you get up and speak. And I accept that, Lord. And we are going to turn to Matthew 14. Sorry, Matthew 25. My apologies. We'll get to 14. Matthew 25, where it talks about the parable of the talents. And it says this. For the kingdom of heaven is like a man traveling from a far country who called his own servants and delivered his goods to them. And to the one he gave 5 talents, to the other 2, and to the other 1, to each according to his own ability. And he went on his journey. Then he who had received the 5 talents went and traded with them and made another 5 talents. And likewise, he who had received 2 gained 2 more. But he who had received 1 went and dug it in the ground and hid his Lord's money. After a long time, the Lord of those servants came and settled accounts with them. So he who had received the 5 talents came and brought 5 other talents, saying, Lord, You delivered to me 5 talents. Look, I have gained 5 more talents beside them. His Lord said to them, well done, you good and faithful servant. We were faithful over a few things. I will make you ruler over many things. Enter into the joy of your Lord. He who also had received 2 talents came and said, Lord, you delivered to me 2 talents. Look, I have gained 2 more talents beside them. His Lord said to him, well done, good and faithful servant. You have been faithful over a few things. I will make you ruler over many things. Enter into the joy of your Lord. Then who had received the 1 talent came and said, Lord, I knew you to be a hard man, reaping where you do not sow and gathering where you do not scatter seed. And I was afraid. I was afraid. And went and hid your talents in the ground. Look, there you have what is yours. But the Lord answered and said to him, you wicked and lazy servant. You knew that I reap where I do not sow and gather where I do not scatter seed. So you ought to have deposited my money with bankers. And at my coming I would have received money back, my own money back, with interest. So take the talent from him and give it to him who has 10 talents. For to everyone who has, more will be given, and he will have abundance. But for him who does not have, even what he has will be taken away. And cast the unprofitable servant into the outer darkness. There will be weeping and gnashing of teeth. And we have been reminded many a time that we are to use our talents, not to achieve in the sporting world, not to achieve on the business arena. Yes, they are platforms. But we are to use the talents that God has given each and every one of us to bring the good news. As John has just reminded us, we must wake up. The Word is telling us to wake up, share the good news. And as we look at more serious issues of what God has given us, He's going to say to each and every one of us, I gave you my Son, Jesus Christ. I gave you my Son, Jesus Christ. What did you do with Jesus? As we look at Jesus and the name of Jesus, the person he was, the Son of God, the Word that became flesh, walked amongst men, dwelt with us, showed us the way, our great shepherd. I think the greatest gift is His Son and salvation. Salvation unto those who call upon the name of Jesus. There is no other name which men, women can be saved, but the name of Jesus. He was also the only way to the Father. Nobody comes to the Father but by me. Everyone who calls upon me will be saved. One day, and there is a day coming, that every knee shall bow and tongue confess that Jesus is Lord. What have you done with that teaching? Have you shared the gospel with someone? We all have our areas of influence, even the tea girl, even the maid, even the gardener. In the name of Jesus, I know there are many, many names, and I'm sure every one of you could name another name or a blessing through the name of Jesus. But there is a peace that comes in Jesus, in the name of Jesus. And the scripture I'm going to look at, just to underline that, is Romans 15:13. And it says, now, as Paul is speaking to the Romans, he says, and now may the God of hope fill you with all joy. May the God of hope fill you with all joy and peace in believing, that you may abound in hope by the power of the Holy Spirit. And when we sang this last song, Jesus Christ, our living hope. Jesus Christ, our living hope. And I remember a few weeks ago, the very first song that we sung was Cornerstone. I was on a men's meeting. We might not have been in the right doctrine, but it was a men's camp. And that was also the first song that was sung. Christ alone, my cornerstone. I was so touched and so overwhelmed. I actually went to the back. I lifted up my hands. I started praising and worshiping. And sure, did I start crying. And you know, being an ex-parabat, have you been in the thick of things in Angola? You don't cry. Even if you lose your comrades with you, you don't cry. But that day I cried. And I still walked out there and I phoned a dear pastor friend of mine who's actually an evangelist. And he says, what's going on? What's going on? Is there problems there? I said, no, I'm just filled with the love of God. There is a joy welling up in my heart that has brought me to this state. And above all, just the confirmation of what we've been preaching and speaking about over the last couple of days, last 2 weeks, has been brought to the forefront. And I'm so grateful for that. And as we look at Cornerstone, we just come back to Romans 15:13. Talking about the hope that is to fill you. And in that song of the cornerstone, it says, our hope is built on nothing less than the blood of Christ and His faithfulness. And we were reminded, the cross, just a few weeks ago, the three crosses, the bloodshed, dying on the cross, buried, rising on the third day. We must never forget that. And this is all part of, are you sharing this? Are you sharing this? I didn't up until a few months ago, until I was challenged. Then we go on and it says, all joy and peace in believing. Believing, believing. Now may the God of hope fill you with all joy and peace in believing. And we're reminded, and we'll go to Mark chapter 9. Right in the beginning of Mark chapter 9, we are told about the Mount of Transfiguration. And what happens? It says, on that day Jesus took with him three disciples. He took Peter, James, and John. and up they went. And then the story begins just before they come down. There's 9 disciples at the bottom of the mount. Why didn't they go up? Were they not in tune? Were they not obeying? Were they not trusting? We would never know. But one thing we know, they couldn't do what Jesus did. Now, I know we can't say we will never be like Jesus, but he commanded his disciples to heal the sick. But they couldn't do it. I call them the 9 left behinders. And we need to pray that we will not be left behind. We need to be in there with Jesus. We need to be up the mountain, fellowshipping, not only with Jesus, but to have been able to hear Moses and Elijah. And right at the end, before they came down, where God said, "This is my son." This is part of the Jesus that he has given us. And as we look through that scripture, as Jesus comes to, there's a multitude there and there's a debate with the scribes. And there's obviously a bit of a problem. What's the problem? And it says this. And he asked the scribes, "What are you discussing?" And one of the crowd answered and said, "Teacher, I brought you my son, who is a mute spirit." And it talks about how it seizes him and how it throws him in the fire, etc., etc. And it's amazing how Jesus rebukes them. And he says, "Oh, you faithless generation, how long shall I be with you? How long shall I bear with you? Bring him to me." Then they brought him to him. And when he saw him, immediately the spirit convulsed him. And he fell on the ground and wallowed, foaming at the mouth. So he asked the father, "How long has this been happening to him?" How long have we had a problem, maybe with 1 or 2 of our children, a relative? How long? How long? And he said, "From childhood. And often he has thrown him both into the fire and into the water to destroy him. But if you can do anything, have compassion on us and help us." Jesus said to him, "If you can believe, all things are possible to him who believes." Believe in the name of Jesus Christ, God's word, and the power of his Holy Spirit. If you can believe, all things are possible to him who believes. Immediately the father of the child cried out and said with tears, and this is what I'm talking about, "Fill you with all joy and peace in believing." This is what the man says, "Lord, I believe. Help my unbelief." I know you've heard it many a times. This will definitely not be the first time. Maybe for some youngsters, so be it. But by the Spirit, we need to press in. We need to seek the Lord. And we need to get to this. The Word also tells us that to each, a portion of faith has been given or dealt. But we need to work it. We need to seek, seek, and seek. So we come back to John 18:36, which relates to the kingdom that is from above and not from below. It is believing in that, and it's not just a philosophy, it's not a concept, it's not a Google, it's believing in the Word of God. And as we look at John 18:36, Jesus clearly says to Pilate, "My kingdom is not of this world. If my kingdom were of this world, my servants would fight, so that I would not be delivered to the Jews. But my kingdom is not from here. Therefore, if it is not from here, it's definitely not an earthly kingdom, but a kingdom from above. It is a kingdom from above. It is not a kingdom that we can see with the naked eye. It's not a kingdom that we can switch on, touch, feel. It's a kingdom that is only seen by faith in the Lord Jesus Christ. We then can turn to Matthew 13, where Jesus actually talks about the kingdoms. And we were taught about the sower and the seed. But straight after that, we get taught about the wheat and the tares. And Jesus actually spoke parables. Parables. And as I looked at the word parable, it says it's a strong story that illustrates a moral or a lesson. But they're both morally lessons to us. And in the tares, he actually says that the kingdom of heaven is like a man who sowed good seed in a field. But while the men slept, the enemy came and sowed tares among the wheat and went his way. But when the grain had sprouted and produced a crop, then the tares also appeared. So the servant of the owner came and said to him, "Sir, did you not sow good seed in your field? How then does it have tares?" He said to them, "An enemy has done this." The servant said to him, "Do you want us to go and gather them up?" But he said, "No, lest while you gather up the tares, you also uproot the wheat with them. Let both grow together until the harvest. Let both grow together until the harvest. And at that time of the harvest, I will say to the reapers, 'First gather together the tares and bind them in bundles to burn them. But gather the wheat into my barn.'" He talks about the kingdom as a mustard seed, where it's the smallest seed of all the seeds. A man sows it, and it becomes one of the biggest trees, and birds come and nest in there. He also talks about the leaven, for the kingdom of heaven is like a woman who has three portions, and she leavens them, and overnight it works through. But he spoke those parables to the multitudes. And it's when he was alone, the next parable on kingdom, he speaks to his disciples about a hidden treasure, which says, "Again, the kingdom of heaven is like treasure hidden in a field, which a man found and hid. And for the joy of it, the joy of this kingdom, this pearl that he has found, he goes and sells all that he has and buys the field." He talks about the pearl of great price. "Again, the kingdom of heaven is like a merchant seeking beautiful pearls, who, when he had found one pearl of great price, Jesus Christ, went and sold all that he had and bought it." Talks about the dragnet, for the kingdom of heaven is like a dragnet. It is cast out and it is dragged to shore. And men sit there and they separate the fish. Those that they can eat and sell or whatever it is, they are kept, they are put in a vessel. The rest are just thrown away. We come back to the boy that was healed. Remember what the boy's dad said. "I do believe. I do believe. But I think he might have been forced to go down to wherever Jesus was. I think his friends, whether they had met the day before, over the last week, the people in the village would have said, you know, there's a man down in the village, his name is Jesus. Take your son there. And out of, I think, peer pressure, he took his son. And that, I think, was the reaction. I do believe, everyone's told me, I should believe and bring my son to you and help me with my unbelief. And he's speaking to us. Because if the Lord tells us, when you pray, rejoice and believe that you have received it. I'm working on it. And then we go right to the end there, as his disciples ask, why couldn't we do it? Why could we not heal this young boy? I think it was intimidating. It might have been humiliating to them. It might have taken whatever they had out of them. And they asked Jesus, why could we not cast that demon out? And he says to them, this one only comes out through prayer and fasting. How's your prayer life? Quibus, how's your prayer life? How's your fasting? And as we look at prayer, there's many kinds of prayers. Many, 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 many prayers. I think there's about 120 references that you can go to look and find out verses and scriptures on prayer. And I'll just mention a few. Where his disciples, Jesus had been praying and he comes to them, and it's in Luke 11:1, where he says, Lord, teach us to pray. Lord, teach us to pray. We look at John 17:19. Where it talks about, Jesus is talking about, I'm praying for those who you have given me, not those in the world. And he says, I pray for them. I'm not praying for the world, but for those you have given me, for they are yours. We also reminded of Matthew 6:5-6, where he says, and when you pray, Do not be like the hypocrites. For they love to pray standing in the synagogues and the street corners to be seen by others. But when you pray, go into your room, close the door, and pray to your Father who is unseen. Then your Father who sees what is done in secret will. It's so opposite to the normal thinking. In your closet, on your own. And I know Ian Bounds quotes and he says that your life outside the closet, your life out in this world, will only be as strong as your prayer life in your closet. We have a prayer going from Elisha, where Elisha prayed. He's for his servant. He says to the Lord, open his eyes, Lord, so that he may see. Then the Lord opened the servant's eyes and he looked, and the hills were full of angels. And the enemy came down towards him, and Elijah prayed, strike this army with blindness. So he struck them with blindness. We have Jeremiah praying, saying, I do not pray for this people or offer any plea or petition for them, because I will not listen when they call to me in the time of their distress. We have Jeremiah praying once again, and he says, please hear our petition and pray to the Lord your God for this entire remnant. And in Colossians, as Paul says, and pray for us. pray for us that God may open a door for our message so that we may proclaim the mystery of Christ for which I am in chains. Those are all our prayers. It's all that we should be praying for ourselves and others. And then I think, well, it is two of the most powerful prayers or situation of prayer in the Bible for me was in the Garden of Gethsemane, where Jesus prays a number of times that the cup may be removed. Father, if it be your will, take or remove this cup from me. But in that, he had his disciples and he had brought these disciples with them. And he actually personally asked them, please watch and pray with me. This is what he says as he comes and he returns. I know he returned three times to them, but the third time he says, come, the hour is at hand. Let's arise and go, for the betrayer is at hand. But in those two other visits to his disciples, he says, watch and pray that you will not fall into temptation. The spirit is willing, but the flesh is weak. Keep watch and pray so that you will not fall. I heard a preacher speaking about Jeremiah, speaking about Habakkuk. And we know the Habakkuk prayer of faith. We know that. We should know that. That the olives have lost its fruit. There is no blossoms on the fig tree. There either the olives have shot its fruit. There's no wine. There's no calves in the store. There's no grain in the store. Yet I will praise the Lord. But it's about a chapter and a half before that, he says a very remarkable saying. He says, I will stand my watch. It's exactly what Jesus is saying to his disciples. Could you not watch and pray? And Habakkuk says, I will stand my watch. I will be on the rampart. And when I am asked, I will speak. We need to be on the rampart. We need to be the watchman. And I just want to look at Luke chapter 6. And it starts verse 12. Here's the Son of God. We haven't had John, we haven't had Matthew telling us what Jesus said. Luke, we haven't got Elijah, we haven't got Jeremiah, but we've got the Lord Jesus Christ. And there's a documentation of what he did with prayer. And it says in verse 12, now it came to pass in those days that he went out to the mountain to pray and continued all night in prayer to God. And when it was day, he called his disciples to himself, and from them he chose 12, whom he also named apostles. Simon, who he also named Peter, Andrew his brother, James and John, Philip and Bartholomew, Matthew and Thomas, James the son of Alphaeus, and Simon called the Zealot, Judas the son of James, and Judas Iscariot, who would also become a traitor. So he now comes down. It still says here, he called the 12. He hadn't quite descended yet. But then as it says here, as he came down with them and stood on level place with a crowd of his disciples, a great multitude of people from all Judea and Jerusalem and from the sea coast of Tyre and Sidon, who came to hear him, and he healed all their diseases. I know it says to hear him and be healed of all their diseases, as well as those who were tormented with unclean spirits, and they were healed. And the whole multitude sought to touch him, for power went out from him and healed them all. And then soon after that, he has the teaching of the Beatitudes. So here is Jesus. Prayer all night. Why was it all night? I do believe that it's he had to choose his 12 very important key men who would eventually birth his church. He also had to heal the multitudes, because it says, and power flowed from him. So he had obviously received that, be it an impartation, be it an anointing from God, that left him. And then the teaching of the Beatitudes. How many of us spend time in prayer? Because we need to get out there and share the good news. And we can only speak and say what we are. We cannot hear, we cannot go to a conference and get all hyped up, and Monday we are now going to town with the Bible. It does not work like that, unfortunately. It's seeking God on your own in prayer and supplication. And just to finish off, I want us just to go to Ephesians chapter 6, verse 10. And we know it all, we've read it all. I'm sure some of us, when we've had really testing times, a friend will tell us a scripture, WhatsApp a scripture, telling us, go and put on the armor. It's a favorite. And Paul actually says this, finally, my brother, be strong in the Lord and in the power of his might. Be strong in the Lord and in the power of his might. Put on the whole armor of God. Why? So that you may be able to stand. And if it's ever a day and a time that we need to stand, it's now. It's now. Stand what? Stand against the wiles of the devil. For we do not wrestle against flesh and blood, but against principalities, against powers, against evil rulers of this age, against spiritual hosts of wickedness in heavenly places. Therefore, take up the whole armor of God, that you may be able to stand in the evil day, and having done all, to stand. Putting on the helmet of salvation, unfortunately, is not a conference. It's not a 3-day thing where you just put the helmet on. That helmet of salvation is knowing your God and knowing his word. Is knowing your word, knowing your God. The shield of faith. You've got to know what Jesus said. You've got to know the scriptures to bring it all into line with whatever situation. Get the word in you as much as you can. We know Jesus was tempted, and it's only by the word that he overcame the 3 temptations. Get to know the word. And then he says, stand therefore, having girded up your waist of truth. Know the truth, because we are told it's the truth that sets you free. Having put on the breastplate of righteousness. And as I said right in the beginning, we have no righteousness of our own. It's the blood of Jesus Christ and his righteousness. And having shod your feet with the preparation of the gospel of peace, above all, taking the shield of faith, with which you will what? Be able to quench all the fiery darts of the wicked one. And we know in the old days, those shields, as a representation, they were wet, so the fiery darts, the enemy, the arrows that were shot with flames on them would be quenched by the water on the shield. But it's deeper stuff than that for us. It's spiritual stuff to quench all the attacks, to overcome by the word of God. And then we talk about the sword of the word. That is vital, to know the word. But where I'm going here, and it says here, in verse 18, pray always. It's amazing that we have this teaching on armor and the importance and the essentiality of the armor, the full armor of God. And then right after that, Paul is telling them, pray. Pray. And this is what he says. Pray always. With all prayer and supplication in the Spirit, being watchful to this end with all perseverance and supplication for all saints. He then goes on to say, pray for me. Pray for me. That utterance may be given to me, that I may open my mouth boldly to make known the mystery of the gospel. And then he goes on to say, for which I am an ambassador in chains. And we need to get a revelation of in chains, in a Roman prison, naked, beaten, in the stock. And yet he can still write these amazing mysteries to all the different churches. And then he goes on to say, that I may speak boldly as I ought to speak. That's a prayer for us. With what have you been given? We need to go and speak boldly. He talks about all times. Acts 6:4 reminds us that they were devoted to prayer. Romans 12:12. They devoted and were steadfast in prayer. Colossians, Paul tells the church, continue earnestly in prayer. The Ephesians chapter talks about all supplication. Now, supplication, or to supplicate, is to ask or entreat humbly or earnestly. And a supplication is bent or kneeled. All perseverance, Paul says, all perseverance. We come back to the Garden of Gethsemane. Simon, are you still sleeping and resting? Could you not watch 1 hour? Simon, are you still sleeping? Could you not watch 1 hour? And then he says, pray for all men, pray for all saints. And he says in Timothy, I exhort you, therefore, first of all supplication, prayers, intercession, and giving of thanks be made for all men and saints. Doesn't say saints, I've just added in. Pray for your pastor. Pray for the overseers. Pray for those who are bringing you the word. It's not easy. I've just learnt a few more things than what the normal person in the congregation here. It's tough. The challenges, not so much out there, but within the family circles, it's a challenge, because there you're vulnerable. Pray for them. Pray for them. And to sum it all up, I do believe that the disciples of Christ must be praying people. Without distinction of nation, sect, rank, or party, our duty as Christians is summed up in two words. Godliness, that is the right worshipping of God, and honesty, that is good conduct to all men. When our conduct is right with those around us, they will be open to hear the good news. They would want to hear about this Jesus. They would want to hear, what is it that you have? You haven't lost your cool. This happened and that happened, and you have not been moved. But as we come back to our opening scripture, as Paul writes to the Romans, now may the God of hope fill you with all joy and peace in believing. Because it's in that believing that you will receive all joy and peace. Believe in no other name but the name of Jesus Christ that will surpass all understanding. That you may abound in hope. We sung that. Jesus Christ, my living hope. It was actually a repeat. It was one of those verses or a song or a lyric that we said over and over again. Jesus Christ, my only hope. And this hope only comes by the power of the Holy Spirit. Let us pray. Father, I thank you for this time. And I pray, Father, that you would take the words that have been said, even the words, Father, that were sung in the beginning. And even as John shared in Romans chapter 13, that we would take those words, Father, and do something about it. As Jesus' disciples came to him and said, Lord, Lord, explain this and explain that. And he did so. But he also at one stage said to him, blessed are those who hear the word and walk therein. Blessed are those who hear the word and do something about it. And Father, we know that these biblical truths, these mysteries of your word that you are revealing to us, we know, Father, we can only get the revelation from you through your word and by your Spirit opening our eyes that we may see. And I pray, Lord, that we would go our way and determine in our hearts to seek more your kingdom. This kingdom, Father, the kingdom of this world is so about. It's in everything. It's just all over, Father. But I pray, Lord, that by your Spirit, you will help us to look up, because that is where our hope comes from. We look up to the heavens. And Father, I pray that our looking up will be from a stance of supplication on our knees seeking you. We have been reminded once again, Father, we need to love. We need to love. Help us in this area, not to brush certain people aside or certain people who just didn't want to listen, but help us to love with a godly love that only comes from you, Father. Thank you for this time, Father. To you be all the honor and all the glory in the precious name of Jesus Christ. Amen.